And that's Acts 28, starting with verse 17. After 3 days, he called together the local leaders of the Jews, and when they had gathered, he said to them, "Brothers, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. When they had examined me, they wished to set me at liberty because there was no reason for the death penalty in my case. But because the Jews objected, I was compelled to appeal to Caesar, though I had no charge to bring against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I have asked to see you and speak with you, since it is because of the hope of Israel that I am wearing this chain." And they said to him, "We have received no letters from Judea about you, and none of the brothers coming here has reported or spoken any evil about you. But we desire to hear from you what your views are, for with regard to this sect, we know that everywhere it is spoken against." When they had appointed a day for him, they came to him at his lodging in greater numbers. From morning till evening, he expounded to them, testifying to the kingdom of God, and trying to convince them about Jesus, both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. And some were convinced by what he said, but others disbelieved. And disagreeing among themselves, they departed after Paul had made one statement: "The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your fathers through Isaiah the prophet, 'Go to this people and say, you will indeed hear, but never understand, and you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and truth, and I would heal them. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will listen." He lived there 2 whole years at his own expense, and welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
The children can be dismissed to children's church. For those of you that song sounds familiar, that is from the movie The Bridge on the River Kwai. I will be discussing some parts of that movie, and I think since it was made in the 60s and won a bunch of Academy Awards, I don't have to worry about a spoiler alert. You should have seen it by now if this bothers you at all, that I'm telling you about it and the ending. So I don't feel bad. Some of you may walk out in disgust right now, but I don't see that happening. What happens in the movie is this. It's World War II. They're British prisoners. They're marched into a prison camp in western Thailand. They are prisoners that are to be building a bridge on a specific river. There is a gentleman who is acted by Alec Guinness. And some of you that do not know who Alec Guinness is, he is Obi-Wan Kenobi in the Star Wars movies. All right? This is pre-Star Wars. We have a younger Guinness here. And in the movie, his name is Lieutenant Colonel Nicholson. He takes a stand for his men. He has come into a camp and he is non-compromising. They have been a group of men that have been forced to build a bridge, and they have done everything they can to make it not work because they don't want to benefit the enemy. That is what's going on. They are purposely doing that. At a certain point, Nicholson, Guinness, decides that to keep up the men's morale, to build the best bridge possible so that it will always be remembered through British ingenuity that that bridge exists, even to the point of having a plaque that says who built it. And that bridge would benefit the enemy. So do you understand the picture here? And if you haven't seen the film, excellent film. There are other prisoners, three that attempt escape. Two of them die. One lives. His name, he is acted by William Holden. Okay? And Holden's job is to get back and make sure that that bridge has not been built. Let me pray, and then let's get into our time in the Word here. Father, thank you for what your Word teaches. There are some hard, tough things in it. There's a lot of really nice stuff, God. Things that we like to hear about you, that you're forgiving and gracious and loving and things along that line. But that's half the message. There's also some hard sayings. Even your son Jesus, who for whatever reason some have crafted, we might even do this, they've crafted a Jesus that is a little more acceptable. He's the kind of person that is pliable, and he can be adjusted to whatever I want him to be. Father, help us to look at him not just as lamb, but as lion. And so as we're spending this time in the Word, as we're working through this story together, that, Lord, you would, as we're wrapping up this time in Acts, you would help us to realize that we are writing Acts 29, 30, 31, and beyond, spiritually speaking. Obviously, inspiration is done, God, but your Spirit is still working today. We pray it is in Grace Bible Church in Warrenton, Missouri, and beyond. So, Father, would you do that work? Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. There's an irony in Christian schools and in Christian churches today that says or thinks, if I, out of a desire to be heard, tone down some of the things that I believe, I may receive a bigger audience. I may have more that would come and hear me. If I say something that is very inclusive and hammer on that or discuss that or have conversations based on that dialogue. I can use all the fancy words. If I have all of that, then I include more people into the conversation. And I understand, even Paul says, I've become all things to all people so that by all means I might reach some. But do you see how dangerous that can be? That I would make Jesus this inclusive, he receives everybody, and theologically and biblically, that's true. But they are on his terms, they're on the terms of his Father. And so, if I create a Jesus that, you know, certain things aren't, that don't bother him. I know there's some people that are like, they're really worked up about sin, and they're really worked up about hell, and they're really worked up about some of these things that they think are core theological issues. If I have a Jesus that says, you know what, let's do this. we will discuss those hard things. Let's save it for Wednesday night. Maybe in our Bible studies. Maybe Sunday school. But boy, if some of those people came to Sunday school and then they came to church, or they came, they might come to church and they might show up early, and then so they'd hear about the fact that God has some thoughts concerning sin. God has some thoughts concerning hell. I'm just picking those things. I mean, there's a host of other issues that are hard sayings, and it's not just, oh, that's just your interpretation of that. It really, if practically speaking, literally grammatically, I look at this book and it talks to me, and I actually believe it's the Word of God. I don't pick out just what I like and that's what I hold on to, and the rest I kind of cut out and throw away. If I do that, there's some stuff in there. Stuff that I don't even necessarily like to hear sometimes. I'll be honest with you. Not everything in the Bible, I like, oh, this is great. God's beating me over the head with this. But I need to hear it because it's the truth. And so at a time where many Protestant churches were mainstream, have put aside different things that out of wanting to include and compromise might sound like a bad word, but it can be a bad word. It's actually not a bad thing a lot of times in marriage and other places, but God says, if God's got this standard that he gives, I can't, out of thinking, you know, I know he said that, but what I think he really meant is this, because it hurts people's feelings if I mention these things. They don't like talking about hell. They don't like the fact of mentioning sin. They don't like... So let's not do that. I want to include. And so that's mainstream Protestantism. But what's happening on the tail of that is evangelical churches, which I would include ourselves in, which is people that take Scripture seriously, literally. We hold two different things. And on the tail of that, we see we didn't learn from their lessons, because a lot of those places have become museums for Christianity. They literally, they're just shells of what really could be going on in life. They've got a form of godliness, but no power. And instead of the evangelical church looking at it and go, we don't ever want to go there. We go, oh, well, I'll try that. And decade goes by, and decade goes by, and decade goes by, and we've become that. It's a shell. Well, if you preach those things, people won't come to your church. If you say those things, you might scare some people off. Okay, I'm telling you right now, if that's the case, then maybe Grace Bible Church isn't the place for you. Love you. There's a lot of inclusive things in the Word. There's some hard stuff. That's why we, and by the way, all different forms of preaching, there's no like thing that's set that says, and this is the one that God blesses most. There's some churches that do topical. We've talked about this before. Every month they have a topic. It isn't a bad thing if they stick with the Word of God. But it's not, wonder what's going on, and how things are going, the winds of change, and we harbor on those things, and that's all we preach, we'll hit on this because this is a felt need, and we'll think, and here's the thing, and here's why we do this here. Granted, one of the reasons is because I'm here, okay? And so I believe in expository preaching. Expository preaching is usually we're going to take a book and we're going to work through it, and we're going to work through it all. So that there's no place in a, oh man, that chapter, oh, we, you know, Bessie had this issue, and if we talk about that chapter, that might hurt her feelings. Well, let's jump, we don't jump. Bessie's going to hear it. By the way, I don't know if there's any Bessies here. Oh, that girl must be amazing. So that's why we do that. So we work through it. Look at some of these quotes with me. First one. The mainstream, this is from Steve Bruce, God is Dead, Secularization in the West. The mainstream Christian churches are declining in popularity, and the conservative Protestant churches are losing their doctrinal and behavioral distinctiveness. The world is watching us, and if they see that we doctrinally don't believe certain things, if we start to change on different issues, and sometimes change is good, but when it comes to doctrinal issues, that's a whole other thing. Or they look at our marriages, they look at how our dating life is, they look at how we handle alcohol in the area of getting drunk. They look at, and I could keep listing things. Some of those things are peripheral. Just how we have accepted certain things and have acted like these things are okay because sexual immorality is wrong and sinful and it should be mentioned. Okay, that should be talked about. So that has bearing on our marriages. That has bearing on our dating life. Amen? Alcohol, if it leads to drunkenness, is a sinful behavior. Amen? I mean, that's kind of in the Bible, all right? It is in the Bible. It's not kind of in the Bible. And then I could list a host of other things, and I hesitate to list them because I don't want to, and that may say, well, you're trying to include people, okay? But there's like issues of homosexuality that are not addressed. There's issues of gender that are not necessarily addressed by some churches, and we just want to, or we will accept what the world says on that, and we will appear to be more loving by doing that. And that's happening. And it's creating something that when the world would look at us and they would see us and we call ourselves Christians and do you go to Grace Bible Church and is that what a person at Grace Bible Church believes and holds on to and thinks, they would go, you're no different than us. And by the way, we are no different. We're all sinners. We understand that. But we've got this amazing God that helps us with this junk. So that we would, so that we would look around and go, and by the way, we're just so fantastic. And we it's not us, it's Christ. And so if you're sitting here and those, and I just mentioned those, and those issues are not issues to you, and like, oh, quit it. Don't talk about that stuff. Don't, it makes me uncomfortable. I've been there, or I'm kind of in there now, or something. Welcome to what God does. And what it should do, instead, lead us to repentance as opposed to, don't talk about it, let's just all get along. Next quote, please. Edward Norman in Secularization, New Century Theology. Christianity is not being rejected in modern society. What is causing the decline of public support for the church is the intense insistence, or is the insistence of church leaders themselves in representing secular enthusiasm for humanity as core Christianity. We're so wanting to be, and I'm saying we, but because that's how the world is looking, we're so wanting to be so inclusive that we're just putting things aside and saying, we're not going to talk about that stuff. We're not going to address it. And I'm saying, and I, by the way, I don't want to be a jerk, but I want to be biblical. And I want in love to have these discussions, in love to communicate, because the Bible says Jesus was full of grace and truth. But he was full of truth also. And the pendulum is slowly but surely swinging. And as we take a stand against that pendulum, it's going to get interesting. Next quote, please. There are thousands of pastors and churches today that do not think that clear biblical doctrinal views are vital in the life of the church or the believer. They believe it is possible to grow a healthy church while leaving the people with few and fuzzy thoughts about what God is like. But ignorance about God is never a mere vacuum. The cavity created by ignorance fills up with something else. And I want to tell you that something else is false teaching. It's false doctrine. It's false believing. So if I'm just going to, we're not going to talk about that. We're not going to address it. It's not going to be something that we're going to focus on, because those are hard conversations to have. That's the same thing as a home where dad, we're not taking a stand on different issues. And the inmates are running the asylum. And mom, by the way. It's not like mom's part of the inmates running the asylum, okay? They're both wardens working together. And by the way, those of you that are sitting here and you go, no, wait a second, is he talking, because you're not married yet, you're young, is he talking about me? Oh, someday you'll probably be a warden. All right? And then you'll understand. Right? We're all, and the wardens here are sinners too. And so Paul, I think as this book is written, it doesn't write to us, it doesn't tell us about his execution, but he will be executed soon. His head will be cut off. He's made it to Rome. And if you read this and you look at it, and it looks like this is a story that it looks like there's an ellipsis at the end of this. You look at it and it's dot, dot, dot. It's not... it's not farewells, like the typical letters, because it's not a letter; it's a narrative. It's a historical thing. And if you read it, and it's one of those things, it's almost like the movie. I don't know if you've ever had this, where the credits start rolling, and you're going, "That's it, it's done." And I think it's purposeful. I think that's why he made it like this. I think he made it like this because he's saying it's not done. I'm going to still do it through you. Although there's no more scripture being written, I've prayed that twice, because I say, you know, the book is still being written. Some of you are like, oh, wait a second. I didn't want any, like, nervousness. Is he believing something? Where's these hidden books, all right? It's done. But I got to believe that the Spirit of God is still using you and me. And desiring to continue his work in and through us. So let's work through these last few verses together as we're finishing up the book of Acts and see where he takes us. Point number one, if you want to take notes, there's a section in your bulletin to do that. And under this message, stop crying, all right? Point number one, they have a desire to meet. They have a desire to meet. Look at verse 17 again. With what Moses read to us. After 3 days, he called together the local leaders. Remember, he has now made it to Rome. The local leaders of the Jews. And when they had gathered, he said to them, brothers, and that word brothers there isn't the idea of being a fellow Jew, not as a Christian brother, but as brethren in the area of you are my kinsmen. Brothers, though I have done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. The leading men of Rome's Jewish community included the prominent men from the synagogues. He always went first to the Jewish community. I'm telling you, this is a challenge to you and me to constantly keep in our mind we are called to love the Jewish people. I think God is modeling something here. There is such a push, and I think it's from the enemy, to be anti-Semitic. Jewish people are a blessed people. They are blessed to be a blessing. Jewish people are not any better than any other people. But they need to be respected. And I see an attack whenever it's done, whether it be through slurs or something as bad as the Holocaust. It is a satanic attack. On a people that are representative of the covenant of God. And so he is not anti-Semitic. That had been said about him many times, but he always pursued his people first. See, the Sanhedrin had falsely accused him of sedition against Rome, of being a leader of a heretical sect, and of violating the temple. Verse 18. Let's keep going. Verse 18. When they examined me, talking about those that had been brought, that he had been brought before, they wished to set me at liberty because there was no reason for the death penalty in my case. Three Roman officials, the tribune Claudius Lysias and the governors Felix and Festus, as well as Herod Agrippa, had affirmed Paul's innocence. You see that through the book of Acts. The Sanhedrin could not prove its case despite three separate hearings, and yet he appeals to Rome. Verse 19. But because the Jews objected, I was compelled to appeal to Caesar, though I had no charge to bring against my nation. It was politically imprudent for either Felix or Festus to release him, and so he appeals to Rome. And it is interesting that through that whole case, he was constantly having things accused of about him. He would take a stand and say, you know, if you can prove this, have at it. Nothing was said. And he never went after them legislatively. He never went or in a courtroom situation. Verse 20. For this reason, therefore, I have asked to see you and speak with you, since it is because of the hope of Israel that I'm wearing this chain. The glorious hope of Israel was the coming of Messiah and the resurrection and kingdom associated with his coming. And it was Paul's preaching of Jesus as the resurrected king that antagonized the Jewish authorities. We just got done in Sunday school listening to a preacher that was emphasizing somewhat of the battle that we're talking about today. We've got two Jesuses that are pushed before people. We've got the meek and mild, soft-spoken Jesus, always serving people. He's very human. He's been tempted yet without sin. He's a kind soul. And then there's the Jesus that is the Jesus from Revelation that is going to come back and clean house. We've got lamb and we've got lion. And if you keep Jesus, and this is very popular in our society today, and especially in American society, whether it be Oprah or whoever, I'm trying to think of who the, maybe Ellen, the people that are just kind, great communicators. And I think that they would talk about this Jesus in a very accepting, loving way. The Lamb Jesus, let's face it, isn't the Lamb Jesus great? I mean, I'm so glad he's that. And ultimately, that lamb got sacrificed. And that lamb got sacrificed. Why? Because of my sin and yours. But if we can keep him relegated to that, he can be kept. I can control a lamb, I think. I haven't done a lot of sheep herding, okay? But I think I can control one. This Jesus, the lion Jesus, no way. This one is just as real. And so the lion Jesus is a resurrected Jesus. That's why when we start talking about Jesus and we talk about the good things, that, you know, giving cold water to somebody, doing kind things, having this situation, we do all this stuff. Who doesn't like that? That's so good. But at some point, then I got to talk about this one. This one, whoa, the resurrected, he's king. He'll be king in heaven forever. Oh, I can't believe, why do you say that? I can't believe, you really believe that? Well, but you believe in Galilean, nice guy, Mr. Rogers, back in Israel. You like him. You don't like the tough one. Same guy. Lamb and lion. And so he could have got up there, Paul, and in the guise of being accepted, in the guise of being inclusive, he could have at some point go, you know what? I just want you to know as I'm before you, we did this guy, Jesus. He's a pretty good rabbi. Good guy. Did a lot of good stuff in Israel. You've read the reports. Good stuff. And he could have stopped there and they go, why are we, this is a bro right here. If he just makes Jesus another rabbi, nice guy, we're all good. And then he goes, oh, but by the way, he died because your sin is And he rose again, and he is king.
Wait a second. Because if he's king, that means I got to follow him. And I like following what I like following. Mostly me.
You see? Resurrection is the deal. That's the dividing line. Because this, all of these things theologically are so huge. Why did he have to die? Because people sin. Well, what's sin?
Well, let's look in the Old Testament. What did he list as sin? What does he list in the New Testament as sin? Oh, man, I do some of that stuff. I think like that.
Yep.
Well, I don't like you telling me that I'm a bad person. You are. And so am I.
But God in his grace didn't just sit there and go, kill them all. He goes, I will put my wrath on my son for you and me. Verse 21. And they said to him, we have received no letters from Judea about you. And none of the brothers coming here has reported or spoken any evil about you. They're being diplomatic. But they were not completely ignorant of Christianity. These were smart men. So that was point number one. Point number two, they have a dark mind. They have a dark mind. Look at verse 23. When they had appointed a day for him, they came to him at his lodging in greater numbers. From morning till evening, he expounded them, testifying to the kingdom of God and trying to convince them about Jesus, both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. I love, you talk about him being inclusive. He's including because he's going, you know what, I'm going to go with your books. I'm going to go with your material and show you he's it from your word. I'm talking, well, isn't that respectful? He enters their culture. He doesn't go, you know, he doesn't just beat the drum on the new thing. Obviously, God did a new thing in Jesus Christ. But he goes, you know what, I'm going to use your stuff. So there's this interest that is growing concerning Christianity. He spent the entire day proclaiming the way of salvation to them. Verse 24. And some were convinced by what he said, but others disbelieved. The gospel does this. The gospel does this. We must make decisions. Jesus will not allow fence sitters. I think people, I hear this all the time. Out of the guys or whatever, it's like it's more noble to not take a stand on anything. And so you just sit on the fence. And at some point, you got to take a stand. Because guess what? If you don't take a stand, you're taking a stand. It's just in midair. And so Jesus, the gospel, this is what God, he gives them. He gives them the gospel. And at some point, some go, I believe that. Some others, I don't believe that. That's what happens. And if we're like, hey, let's just all, could we just kumbaya right now, kumbaya. Let's just,
I love you, brother. I know we don't agree on.
But on core issues, it's not kumbaya.
So he goes right to their scriptures. And disagreeing among themselves, they departed after Paul had made one statement. The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your fathers through Isaiah the prophet. And so in verse 26 and 27, look at this. Go to this people and say, you will indeed hear but never understand, and you will indeed see but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. He's quoting Isaiah 6, 9, and 10. And he said, go and say, because I want to show you, it's in the Old Testament. He quotes their book. Go and say to this people, keep on hearing but do not understand. Keep on seeing but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. They don't want it. They don't want it. They want God on their terms, on their self-righteous way of doing things. I'm good without Jesus. And we aren't.
we aren't. See, the Lord Jesus had quoted this as a rebuke of Israel's hard-hearted rejection of the gospel. Look at verse 28. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will listen. He explained that truth to the Roman church. Romans 11, 17 through 22. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive shoot, were grafted in among the others, and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree. Let me explain this to you. You've got this olive tree, bush, whatever. I think it's a tree. Captain Botany here. And God's using that as a picture of the blessings of God. So it's rooted in God, and the branches are coming out. And it's also a representative of the nation of Israel. They're blessed to be a blessing. So this is growing. And God, who loves everybody, he looks at us Gentiles. I'm not Jewish. But because of Christ, I become Jewish. I'm the new Jew. And so out of love, God goes, I'm not going to leave Gentiles with that situation. I will take those branches, and there's something that happens with botany, with agriculture, with whatever, when it comes to trees, bushes, whatever. They can cut that, attach it, and graft it in so the blessings of that bush can grow, and that branch can actually have life coming out of it. And so God uses that as a picture of you and I, those of us that are not Gentiles, that believe through Jesus Christ, that's what we are grafted into that. So we're growing and blooming based on Christ. Not because we're so amazing, but of who we're tied to. Abide in me. And so that's the picture he's saying. He turned to those Jewish leaders and he says, "This God said this would happen in Isaiah. He said that the truth would be given, that they're blessed to be a blessing, that they're going to have a Messiah. He was promised all through this stuff. I have him sent, and they still want self-religion. They still want religion that they're self-sufficient in and of themselves. I can do this thing. I can be good. I can gain acceptance with God based on my good works, and God will not have it. It has to be on God's terms. And so out of grace, he grafts us in. The temptation would be, now we get it and the Jewish people don't get it. And God won't allow that. Look at what he says here. He says, we're grafted among the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree. Do not be arrogant toward the branches. If you are, remember it is not you who support the root. So we as church, we're now blessed to be a blessing. Love our Jewish brothers and sisters, Gentile, Jewish nationality, all the other nations. We're blessed to be a blessing. But the root that supports you, then you will say, branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. Verse 20. That is true. They were broken off because of their unbelief. But you stand fast through faith. So do not become proud, but fear. We should always be so humble. Why would God love us? We didn't do anything to deserve this. For if God did not spare the natural branches, neither will he spare you. Note then the kindness. This is a powerful verse. We love the kindness, the lamb. Note, he says, note, lamb. Note the kindness and the severity of God. God is wrathful. God hates sin. There's a hell. It's real. So your neighbors that don't know him, they're heading that direction. Without Christ, they're going to hell. And you might, well, this is old time preaching. It's the truth. I can't erase it. And when I erase it, I'm lying. That has bearing then on that uncle that you need to talk to about the Lord. That brother or sister or neighbor that you need to talk to about the Lord. And we just live our lives. We do our things. And I was at the graduation yesterday, and I'm looking at all these people. My heart just, I love where God has placed me. I love this community. And you come by these people, good people, pay their taxes. They didn't kill anybody that day that I know of. Maybe some are cheating on their wives. Maybe some are cheating on their husbands. Maybe there's some things going on, but I don't know. But I do know God's placed me here, not so I can just do my graduation thing. Isn't that great? We're just good people. We're called to more. Without Christ, they're on their way to hell. Do I believe it? Do I believe it? If I don't believe it, let's just close up. We're done. This is a nice little Kiwanis group we're getting together. Kumbaya. Why, that felt so good. It doesn't matter if it isn't the truth. I didn't finish the verse. Severity toward those who have fallen, but kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. Wow, powerful stuff. Verse 30, first part. He lived there 2 whole years at his own expense. Point number 3. They have a desperate need. They have a desperate need. Second part of verse 30. And welcomed all who came to him. He could not leave his quarters, but he could talk. I don't know where God's placed you today. But look what he does. Verse 31. Proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. He never stopped evangelizing. Never. And I pray that that's my heart. I pray that I'm no better. I don't look at people as I'm just a beggar who knows where there's bread. As I walk through the group of people that their children are graduating, amen, just a beautiful day out there yesterday. But I cannot just walk through that. I know some of you are like, can't you turn this off? I can't. There are times where I you know, obviously there's different priorities that come up. But God, give me a compassion for where you've placed me. Give me a compassion. And out of a desire, I could be out of a desire for morale, Colonel Nicholson. A desire to think that I'm not in a battle. I could desire to build bridges that are not helpful. That I'm actually helping the enemy. I think I'm doing something good. We are in a war. I tell you, there's a push today, it seems, to let's not talk about war. Down with the military. I know there's something, probably isn't the biggest problem in Warrenton, but I see it in discussions. There's this thing that's going on that, and I understand the military isn't perfect, okay? Like any organization isn't perfect. I see, even in the news, I'll see, you know, sexual abuse, yes, we understand, and yes, the numbers are amazing, but I would be interesting if we could pick another organization where certain things are going on, what would come out. And so putting that aside, we don't like that thought or metaphor. If we're not careful, we're educated. If we just talk to people, they'll put down their arms. So we're in a battle with ideologies and philosophies and mentalities and a desire to build bridges. We could spend our whole life thinking, I'm being helpful, I'm being good, I'm more loving than these people. Instead of going, no, we're in a war. We're actually in a war. When we become so deluded that the reality hits us that, man, we're in a war. We're in a battle, and I'm not picking people. We wrestle not with flesh and blood. Ideologies, by the way, the way people think affects how they live their lives. Bridge on the River Kwai. They've completed the bridge. It is done. Nicholson is happy. He is so fired up that this has happened. And they're going to see if the bridge was successful because a train is going to be going across it. They've done all the mechanical, that stuff to make sure that the bridge would work. And on the day that is going to happen, Guinness, Nicholson, is patrolling the bridge, and he's looking, and he sees a wire. And what had happened was there were people like William Holden and others that had set up dynamite on it. And he sees the wire and he's like, and he follows it down on the beach and he sees that ultimately it leads to what we've seen on the Wile E. Coyote things, you know, the box that blows up the dynamite, you know. I don't know how often that's used today. I feel like they just push buttons now to blow up casinos that they're not using anymore. And so he sees all this stuff on the beach, and you see Guinness is like, I've got to stop that. And there was going to be a person that was going to blow that up. And Nicholson is stopping that. And at a certain point, and this is where the scene comes, Holden makes his way across the water because he wants to get this taken care of. Look what happens. My prayer for Grace Bible Church, my prayer for my life is that I would not get to the end of the life and go, what have I done? The things that I thought were important in my home, in my personal life, in the life of the church, that I'm thinking I'm being a loving daddy by allowing certain things. I'm being a loving husband. And the most loving thing for my wife and I, if we disagree on issues, that we work through it concerning the Word of God. And listen to her when she's pouring into my life godly understanding, wisdom, instead of going, oh, I just don't want to. And then ultimately, even as the church, that we would not go, what have we done? In an attempt to build bridges with philosophies and ideologies. And it's going to be harder as time goes by. Some of you may be even sitting here and you think it is not the loving thing to do to have those conversations. Just excuse that or just allow that. That's madness. That's madness. I think even the world, because it even said in 1 Corinthians when Paul confronted them in a letter that the sin that was going on, the world looked at it and they were like, really? You, church? I don't want to say, what have I done? I want to say, by God's grace, you did it, Lord. Let's make that our prayer. Let's pray.